Today on the show, we're going down the rabbit hole and talking about the Matrix films. That's right. We taking the red pill today, Beans. I don't like taking pills. So let's start at the beginning with the first Matrix movie, which came out in 1999. And at that time, the World Wide Web had only been available to the public for 8 years. It was fairly new. We were all on shitty dial-up internet. AOL was the king. Most people did not have a cell phone, and if you were lucky enough to have one, it couldn't take pictures. There was certainly no internet on it. I mean, this was before the advent of social media, before MySpace and Friendster. Oh, so this was before everyone just looked at screens and ignored their cats all day, huh? Anyways, I saw this movie in the theater and it was fucking huge. This movie blew my mind, asking questions like, what if your entire reality were fake? What if you could instantaneously download knowledge, which I still wish that I could do. That's such a cool idea. It also introduced the mainstream to vinyl cyber goth kink clothing, and for a lot of people it was their first introduction to a non-binary person through the character of Switch. Oh yeah, aren't the Wachowskis transgendered? Yes, they are. And it's interesting to note that the character of Switch was originally supposed to be played by two different actors, a man IRL and a woman in the Matrix, but Warner Brothers was not ready for that idea at the time, so instead we got an androgynous person. And honestly, I love them. They look so cool, and I still hate how they died.
Oh, all right. Well, what else was so cool about The Matrix? I still don't get it.
Well, Beans, this movie was visually groundbreaking, doing brand new things never seen before in any other movie, namely the super slow motion stunts with the camera moving around. That was like, oh my God, insane. And also the way the agents moved. I mean, people were doing stupid bullet time jokes for years after The Matrix. I mean, people are still doing stupid
bullet time. Excuse me. The Matrix is a big fucking ripoff! There, I said it!
Oh, hey, Berta. What's up, girl? Where's Brock at?
Fuck Brock!
Shit, it's like that, huh? Damn.
Yeah, he's a fucking asshole!
Hey, it's like nothing, and fuck you too, babe. Mwah! But seriously, though, The Matrix totally ripped off Grant Morrison's The Invisibles and Ghost in the Shell, Doctor Who, Neuromancer, Dark City, Blade. I mean, the list goes on and on.
Whatever, I just said it was a ripoff, but okay.
Well, while it is true the Wachowskis are Morrison fangirls, and they did give their design staff the Invisibles and told them to make the movie look like this comic book, and yeah, there are a lot of similarities in the plot.
A lot of similarities? You got a group of alternative-looking freedom fighters searching for their messiah and an anarchist who doesn't want any part of their shit, but eventually joins their crew, becomes an ascended master, and takes on the responsibility of saving a humanity which is imprisoned in a fake reality by insect-like multi-dimensional beings. Oh, I mean, that sounds pretty close here, I don't know.
Yeah, the Wachowskis just switched Morrison's The One being the second coming of Buddha to their The One being the second coming of Christ! Boring!
Yeah, ugh. And honestly, the worst move the Wachowskis made was to stop ripping off Grant Morrison after the first movie.
Yeah, what a couple of fucking hacks!
Okay.
Losers!
I did hear that there were Matrix scripts that predate The Invisibles. Ugh. It came out like around the same time, 1996. But then I also heard that Grant Morrison did some treatments for the Lawnmower Man sequels in 1995, where there's a group of young people who wake up and realize they're in this virtual reality simulation that's controlled by extra-dimensional insect-like beings.
See? Do you see what I'm talking about here?
Yeah, it's a fucking ripoff, just like I said earlier!
And you want to know the worst part of the Matrix trilogy, D?
I have a feeling you're gonna tell me whether I wanna know or not, so.
The Wachowskis are constantly cutting away from Trinity's sweet fat ass in those vinyl pants. It's a fucking crime against humanity, if you ask me.
Oh, please. She doesn't even look that great. She looks like a man, kind of. She's very androgynous.
I mean, she's really hot. Honestly, I'm going to agree with Brock on this one. If I were Carrie Ann Moss, I would be forever sad that they chose not to immortalize my perfect ass on film. I mean, yeah, she's totally. So hot in this untouchable Greek goddess type
Bro,
of way.
Bro, it's like I'm trying to jack in to the Matrix, you know what I'm saying?
Like either of you two dummies would even know what to do with all that woman!
Hey.
Especially you, Brock, with your little teeny weeny penny!
I'm a grower, not a shower. Everyone knows it.
Okay, we're getting way off track here. All right, you guys gotta
you
go.
You can't silence me!
So what do you think, Mom? Is the Matrix a ripoff or what?
We'll never really know. And personally, I'm not interested in the argument of who copied who. Different people come up with the same idea, independent of each other, all the time. It doesn't matter. What matters is that this idea found the perfect vehicle to proliferate itself into the mainstream consciousness, to project itself into millions of minds around the world.
And what idea is that?
For me, the Matrix is about the personal choice we all have to make about whether to wake up and face true reality or stay asleep in an artificial world that feeds off of our life energies. Like, the Matrix is a metaphor for systems of control that operate in the mind, specifically machine mind systems that are devoid of conscience. All they care about is maximizing profits and cutting losses. They don't give a shit about anyone but themselves and their own survival. And The Matrix isn't the only movie asking people to wake up and question their reality. This theme was present in a lot of movies around the turn of the century, a theme which sadly dissipated pretty quickly after 9/11.
Like what other movies?
Like The Truman Show, Dark City, Fight Club, American Beauty, 13th Floor, Eyes Wide Shut, Vanilla Sky. But the movie that I feel like had the greatest impact on me, even more so than The Matrix, would have to be David Cronenberg's eXistenZ.
What the fuck is eXistenZ? Never heard of it.
So there's this chick. She's the leading designer of these ultra popular virtual reality games. She's at a beta test for her newest game, eXistenZ, where there's an assassination attempt on her life. She flees with this PR guy. In the process, her game pod is damaged, which has the only copy of the game on it. So her and this guy must go into the game to check on it to make sure it's okay. But like, as they keep going, the line between the game and reality becomes very blurred, and all is not what it seems.
Okay, well, how did this movie impact you?
Well, this movie got me thinking about how impressed we are by how realistic things look in video games or in movies. And right now, virtual reality is in its infancy, but just imagine how impressed we're gonna be when things seem ultra realistic in a virtual space. But like, why aren't we impressed with how real reality is?
How real reality is? Well, that's really confusing.
Take, for example, the texture of a leaf. In a video game, if there's a realistic looking leaf, you're like, wow, look at this fucking leaf. But then in your everyday life, you could give a fuck about a leaf. Like you pay them zero attention.
Hey now, I pay attention to leaves. I like to chew on them.
It's true, you do love leaves. And movies like The Matrix and eXistenZ, which have us questioning our reality, have really given rise in popularity to the idea of simulation theory.
What's simulation theory?
Simulation theory states that there is a possibility that physical reality is totally fake and is an illusion being projected by an extremely powerful computer program. And if you think about it, we experience physical reality through our senses: sight, taste, touch, sound, and smell. And all of these things are filtered through our brain. Therefore, we do not have actual contact with external objects, but only our mental images of these objects. So, how can we be certain that anything actually exists in the external world? How do we know that physical reality is real? How do I know that Beans isn't just some cat program?
Let me run some beans.exe on your ass. I'll come over here, I'll bite you. But seriously though, computers got y'all humans all freaking out over nothing. Simulation theory sounds fake as fuck. It's stupid. Don't worry about it.
Even though the advent of computer technology has helped launch this idea into the mainstream, simulation theory is actually old as fuck.
Whoa!
That's right, Beans. And the best ancient Matrix analogy comes from Plato's Allegory of the Cave, from the philosophical tradition.
What's Plato's Allegory of the Cave?
Plato's Allegory of the Cave is a thought experiment where there is a cave, and at the bottom, there are all of these people imprisoned in such a way that they can only look forward at these shadow plays that are being projected on the wall in front of them. This is the only thing they're allowed to experience. These shadow plays are being put on by a small number of artists behind them using artificial objects. And few people will ever make it out of the cave. But say there's a prisoner who gets freed and he starts to emerge. At first, he would be confronted by the fire that the artists use to project the shadow plays. And this light would hurt his eyes. It would be painful to him. And so he would most likely say, fuck this, and go back to his station. But say there's another prisoner, a more advanced prisoner, and this guy makes it past the fire and eventually up out of the cave, and he experiences the sun for the first time. At first, he would absolutely be blinded, but if he stuck with it, his eyes would eventually adjust, and he would be able to experience true reality for the first time. And experiencing the superiority of true reality, he would take pity on the prisoners inside the cave, and he would want to return to free them. And so, going back into the cave, he would once again become blinded, only this time by the darkness. And the other prisoners, seeing this blind man, would infer that the trip out of the cave caused the blindness, and therefore, they would not want to go with him, and may actually kill him for trying to force them out of the cave. And that's always been my question about the Matrix. Like, if Neo told everyone in the Matrix, this is all fake, and you can come to the outside and have a holy shitty sweater and eat some gruel, how many people would actually want to go with him? I feel like a lot of people would tell him to go fuck himself. And honestly, you can't red pill everyone at once anyways. There's no way to sustain all of them. So, I mean, it would have to be a gradual process.
Yeah, totally. Cypher was right. I'm not giving up my pouches for dried shitty kibbles. No thanks.
Which brings me to my next ancient Matrix analogy, the Hindu concept of Maya.
Maya, the 3D animation program?
No, Beans. I'm talking about an ancient religious concept. In Hinduism, at the heart of existence, everything is one. Everything is Brahman. And Brahman is pure consciousness. It is unchanging and the only thing that is truly real. Now, Maya, which means a lot of things, unreality, trickery, magic, is the physical and mental reality that our consciousnesses are entangled with. This reality is actually a false projection, and Maya is a dream state akin to the Matrix.
But if everything is Brahman, wouldn't that mean that the Matrix is also Brahman and therefore also real?
Geez, Beans, that's a really great question. The answer is yes and no. The Matrix is unreality, but according to Hinduism, so is Zion, Agent Smith, Trinity, Neo, all of it. They're all just masks for the supreme reality of the universal consciousness of Brahman. There is no God. God is existence. And this dance of reality is really just one big cosmic game of hide and seek.
Oh wow, I love hide and seek. That's a really fun game. Do you think the Wachowskis are influenced by Hinduism at all?
Well, Hindu themes such as reincarnation and karma are heavily featured in some of their other movies, such as Jupiter Ascending and Cloud Atlas. So I think it's pretty safe to say that they were probably aware of the concept of Maya when they were writing the Matrix movies.
So what's the deal with the other Matrix movies?
In 2003, The Matrix returned with two sequels and one animated feature. In May, we get The Matrix Reloaded, and I was just so hyped for this film. Everybody was so hyped for it. I saw it in the theater, and honestly, I felt really let down by it. Like, The freeway scene was really cool and all, but I felt like the story was really starting to lose its way. There was just too much big word talky talk crap that went nowhere. I absolutely hated the architect, and the ending, which was cool, where Neo stops Sentinels, it's like, wow, are they still in some sub-Matrix? Like, did they not even make it out of the Matrix? Is the Zion a trick? Which is some total Twilight Zone shit, super dark, very cool, but no. In October, we get The Matrix Revolutions, and honestly, I didn't go and see it in the theater, and I just watched it for the first time recently, and my instincts to avoid it were totally correct.
Why did you avoid The Matrix Revolutions?
Because I heard that Neo's story turned into a Christ allegory, and at that moment in my life, I was turning away from the church, and I really wasn't looking for any more Christian messaging in my life.
Oh, fair enough. Well, what happened in Revolutions?
Well, we finally get the big battle for Zion, which is just like a giant CGI fuckfest that I care nothing about. Meanwhile, we get some knockoff business where Neo becomes this blinded messiah who can still see with his oracular vision. Him and Trinity make it to the Machine City. Trinity dies. Neo makes a deal with the god and the machine, sacrifices himself to take care of the out-of-control Agent Smith virus, thereby securing peace between the machines and Zion. Zion is saved at the last minute. The end. Meh.
Well, what would you have done differently?
Okay, so instead of Neo being able to control the machines due to some vague system admin powers he acquired from the Source, I would just go full Hindu. Like, Neo transcends the unreality of the Matrix, and then transcends the unreality of physical reality. Some full ascended master business would be a way cooler explanation. And you can even have a similar ending with Smith, except instead you have Neo leaving a pearl of his awareness in each of the people and programs that he frees from the Smith virus. And so these programs, which are already kind of humanish, become more human and therefore more sympathetic to humans. And instead of waging war on them, now they find a way to work together.
Well, what will the machines use to feed off of then if they're not gonna use humans anymore?
Well, according to the Animatrix, the machines used to run off of solar power, and so obviously the humans also love the sun, so why not have these two kooky kids work together to fix the fucked up sky? I think that would be really fantastic. And in review, I feel like I really wish they hadn't developed these two movies at the same time. I mean, they really are just one big movie, but I feel like the ideas within them are not fully baked. And I understand that the studio wanted to save money by filming them together, I get it, but it just needed a little bit more time in the oven because Matrix Revolutions and Matrix Reloaded just really didn't live up to their promise for me.
Well, what's the deal with the Animatrix?
The Animatrix came out in June, and honestly, it's fantastic. There are 9 different animated segments written and directed by a lot of different people that's expanding upon the Matrix universe. I love seeing the Matrix universe in other people's hands and seeing what they do with it. The first 2 segments are a history lesson talking about the human-machine war, where it started, and how we ended up in the Matrix. We also get a backstory on that annoying character, the kid, that we're supposed to like know who he is in Matrix Reloaded and Revolutions. We also get a really cool story about the ship, the Osiris, which is the one that delivered the message to everyone, warning of the oncoming attack on Zion, and some other really cool stuff. So I highly recommend it. Check it out. It's the best Matrix thing besides the first movie.
Well, what about the new Matrix Resurrections movie?
Yeah, The Matrix Resurrections, which came out in December 2021, was a total surprise to me. When I saw the trailer for this film, I was like, A, I can't imagine what it's gonna be about, because, I mean, didn't Neo and Trinity die? Whatever. And B, this movie is totally unnecessary. And it is totally unnecessary. But the fact that the movie acknowledges that it is an unnecessary cash grab by Warner Brothers in this brilliant scene between Anderson and Smith towards the beginning of the film, explaining that Lana Wachowski had to come back because the studio was like, we're making this movie with or without you. Just gives me so much compassion for this movie. I mean, like, things have changed a lot in the past 22 years since the first movie, and the optimism for the future has seemingly evaporated. Like, the internet, this wild and weird frontier for human sharing, has systematically been fenced in and corporatized. It's becoming less fun by the minute. And the waters of the information age, which is this exciting new era where knowledge is the most accessible it's ever been in human history, has been contaminated by a flood of fake news and shitposts. And with the pandemic on top of everything, it's easy to feel despair.
Jeez, you're bumming me out right now.
And as the analyst, our new villain, because even they hate the architect, points out, when coding, hope and despair are nearly identical. So maybe all this is just the other side of the coin. Like, as the pendulum swings back from the high optimism and poor choices of the 90s to the pessimism and consequences of those poor choices of the 20s.
Hard times in the city.
And the analyst, as opposed to manipulating humanity through their beliefs and uncertainties like his boring predecessor, he manipulates humanity through their feelings. He harnesses the fictions they create in their minds to keep the population asleep so the machines can continue to feed off of them. And I look around myself and I'm like, yeah, that's what's happening right now. Because historically and generally, feelings have been repressed. And when they are buried, they become warped and they end up clawing their way to the surface in this really bizarre and fucked up way. It's not healthy at all.
Is that why you always tell me that I gotta feel my feelings?
Exactly. It's important to feel your feelings. It's healthy. And I'm so glad that as a society, we are not stigmatizing feelings as we once were. But that being said, feelings are already being weaponized and used against us. Emotional validation, where we listen to, try to understand, and express acceptance of another person's emotional experience, has been pushed to toxic extremes, and people are being encouraged to fully identify with their feelings at the expense of their critical thinking skills.
I run on pure emotion. I think critical thinking skills are overrated.
My question is, what are the consequences of avoiding uncomfortable feelings and challenging ideas via trigger warnings and safe spaces? Could these ideas, though well-intentioned, be breeding mental weakness and only adding to the growing percentage of people with anxiety and depression? And speaking of depression, just like in real life, the analyst uses pills to keep Thomas Anderson sedated from the truth that he's living in a fake fucking nightmare. But being the doubting Thomas that Thomas Anderson is, he eventually makes it out of the Matrix again with the help of friends, both new and old, but kind of new.
Oh yeah, what did you think of the new Morpheus and the new Agent Smith?
Personally, I was not a fan of the new Morpheus or the new Agent Smith. I want to see Lawrence Fishburne, Hugo Weaving. Also, I did not need to see Jada Pinkett Smith in old age makeup, no thank you. But back to Neo. So he comes out of the Matrix, he's caught up to speed on everything that's been going on, and in another brilliant meta commentary, he states that he feels like nothing's really changed since his sacrifice, that nothing he did mattered. And it feels like the Matrix is the same or worse, and that people gave up and the Matrix won. And honestly, I see where he's coming from. It's hard not to feel that way. From having your favorite sites hijacked by sociopathic algorithms, to fearing the witch huntery of cancel culture, to navigating the nightmare that is social media, and being threatened with a metaverse Walmart, it's a lot to take in. And it feels like the original message of The Matrix is more relevant today than it was in 1999.
Whoa, this is depressing.
What's depressing is seeing the return of the Merovingian, this formerly suave, sexy, sophisticated, shady man bad guy who's now been reduced to this dirty, deranged maniac raving about how art and books and movies all used to be better, how conversation and originality has been replaced by texting and, I quote, face zucker, suck, cock me, climity, wiki, piss, and shit. And I'm just so sad to see him that way. But also, he's not wrong. Like, the rise of big data has heralded a new era of corporate art, where you have these people with pie graphs and charts using this information to try to create content to reach their target demographic so that they can get clicks and views and minutes watched and that sweet subscription money. And that's all it's about.
Well, geez, Mom, should we just fucking give up then?
Don't give up just yet, Beans. I believe that things are darkest before the dawn, and maybe it's my 90s optimism talking, but I feel like as things continue to become more and more absurd, it will only force more and more people to wake up and to decide to opt out of the fuckery.
So what do you recommend if you wanna bust out of the matrix?
Well, Beans, I've got 10 tips and tricks that I found personally helpful. One, awareness. Know that you are inside a matrix. Two, take control of yourself. Believe in yourself. Understand that you have the power of choice. Three, be careful of your inputs. What you read, watch, listen to, who you hang out with. Four, recognize your acquired conditioning and work to deprogram yourself. Five, you can deprogram yourself through mindfulness and meditation practices that keep you in the present moment. Six, take care of your body. Diet, exercise, hydration, breath work, all of it. Seven, find other mentors, guides, and red pills for your journey while still maintaining compassion for the blue pills. Eight, get rid of extra stuff you have in your house. We all have too much shit, get rid of it. Nine, do cool shit. I recently hung out with some wolves. It was awesome. 10, be of service. Be helpful to your friends, your loved ones, your community, in any small way that you can. And that's it.
Wow, that's a lot of stuff, but it's pretty simple.
Yeah, man, keep it simple. Take care of yourself and other people. It's a journey.
Like a spiritual journey?
Yes, Beans, it is a spiritual journey. Kind of like the one John DeFool takes in The Incal, where he goes from being a piece of shit guy to saving the entire universe and coming face to face with his creator.
Oh God. Not another Incal Club commercial.
That's right, Beans. It's another Incal Club commercial. And if you're ready to come on a spiritual journey with me and read Yoderowski and Mobius's far out psychedelic sci-fi graphic novel, Tentatively, in April, order your Incal Box today.
What's in the Incal Box?
Well, Beans, you get a copy of the graphic novel, a enamel Incal pin, there is a bookmark, a signed 8x10, and an 11x17 centerfold poster. And when you become a member on patreon.com/DanikaXIX, you can get a discount code for free shipping for my domestic peeps and $5 off for my internationals. That's it for today. Thank you for watching. And don't forget to subscribe to our channel, like this video, leave a comment below, and ring that bell. These videos will actually show up in your feed.
Oh, come in! Hey, Gorgina! Hey, Berta! Thanks for letting me come over. Ugh! I'm just so tired of Brock's shit! I had to get out of there! He's constantly disrespecting me! He thinks he's like such a fucking cool guy now that he started his own YouTube show! It's like, wow! You've become the thing you hate! Congratulations! It makes me sick!
It sounds like you two are growing apart. And honestly, I never liked him. You can do way better than Brock. You should dump him!
Well, don't think I haven't thought about it. I think about it all the time. I mean, it's like we don't even hate the same things anymore. He's all buddy-buddy with that comic book slut now. Doesn't even care that that she's an evil variant from another timeline. It's like, I can't vanquish this dumb whore all on my own. I don't even know what I'm doing anymore.
Maybe just focus on yourself for a while, Berta. Fuck everybody else. I'm gonna go in the kitchen. I'm gonna pour some big cups of Bruno. We're gonna get all fucked up, and we're gonna talk about it, okay?
Thanks, Georgina. You're a real one. I appreciate it.
Yeah, no problem.
Mm-hmm. Wow, such an asshole. I can't believe this guy. I can't wait to get fucked up and drunk. Georgina.
Hey, Georgina, I'm back. Oh, hey, you're not Georgina.
Yeah, no shit. Who the fuck are you?
Oh, sorry, I'm Chadner. I'm Georgina's cousin. I'm just visiting from the Great Pacific Garbage Patch. What's your name?
My name is Berta.
Wow, Berta, that's a strong name for a strong-looking woman.